All right, welcome to the 10th tutorial on the microcontroller PIC10F200 microcontroller assembly language, whatever we're calling this series. And this one's really interesting. It's very complicated. There's actually a lot of moving parts. So I'm gonna try and keep this short and concise, but I wanna make sure we hit the big things. But the goal for today is to create a code lock. So basically we've been learning how to deal with buttons, how to get inputs and all that sort of stuff. Now we're going to make it so we get an input from those buttons, and depending on how you put the buttons in order, it compares it with the code that you've programmed in it, and depending on whether it's right or it's wrong, you can drive a servo motor to open or close the lock. That's the theory anyway. We are going to be talking about that code comparison, which is actually going to be using some indirect addressing, which if you're familiar with the higher level languages, is basically like pointers. We're gonna talk about the servo, and then we're also gonna talk about two new commands, and then we're gonna go through the structure, and I'm gonna show you all the sort of, it's gonna be a crazy day, but it's gonna be fun. Let's get into it. The first thing I wanna talk about is servos. So if you haven't dealt with a servo, it looks exactly like this. This is an SG90, they're extremely common. Sergey basically said, hey, I have some SG90s lying around, I'll use some, and then I looked around and I just happened to have a couple lying around too. So it's entirely possible that you have a couple lying around. But the way a servo works is with a typical one without the continuous rotation, the ability to go all the way around, you have the capability of saying exactly where you want the servo motor to be. And the way you do that is by changing the duty cycle of a 20 millisecond pulse to it. And it's a little bit hand wavy, but you send it a 20 millisecond pulse, and between 18 or 19 milliseconds of that is low voltage, and then 1 to 2 milliseconds is a high voltage. And depending on how long that is, whether it's 1 or 2 seconds, gives you where your position is. So 1 millisecond of those 20 milliseconds will put it here, 2 milliseconds of those 20 milliseconds will put it there. Now, the reason I say it's a bit hand wavy is because it doesn't have to be exactly a 20 millisecond cycle. So the way we are actually doing it in this program is we're just saying that the low is 20 milliseconds, no matter what, and then we are changing how high the pulse is to change exactly where we want to put this. So this is a very, very high level overview. If you don't know anything about servos, that should get you enough to kind of understand this, but I highly recommend you go look some more somewhere else and find out more about servos. So we'll get into that more in the code. The second thing I wanted to talk about was the two new items, the two new commands that we are going to learn today. The two commands that we need to learn about are RRF, which is rotate right through carry. So we did the rotate left in an earlier command when basically you have your 8 bits and you can rotate it. For me, this is left and this is right. So in a previous program, we took everything and we rotate it left. And now we want to take the same thing, take those 8 bits and just move them over one set. So instead of being 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, now this one is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 on the end. And then it rolls through the carry bit. So that's what the RRF stands for. It's pretty straightforward. And the second thing is we are doing the ANDLW. So that second command is ANDing the literal AND what's in the working register and then outputting whatever the result is from those ANDs. And that is yet another one of those bitwise operators. So incredibly important. If you do understand bitwise, super easy. If you don't, you need to learn more. We don't have the time to deal with it now. But those are the two commands that we have learning and using in this particular program. So the final thing that I want to get into before we go through the structure and how this actually is set up is indirect addressing. Addressing? Something like that. Everything that we've been doing so far has been direct addressing. We basically say, I want to put a value in that register, and we say that register, the GP1 bit of the GPIO register. And so that is the direct addressing. However, indirect addressing is where you are actually dealing with the address. So you're pulling the address of the GPIO. Is it address or address? But you're getting the address. Yeah, that sounds better. You're getting the address of the place that you want to go to. And so instead of saying, let's put something in the GP1 bit of the GPIO register, you're saying, let's put something in bit one of the register that happens to be at this address. You may think, okay, so what is the point of that? That seems like you're putting in an extra step and you're making it even more confusing because now you're dealing with the addresses instead of just going to it straight. So I spent a good 2 to 3 seconds working on this idea that will hopefully make it more clear. So imagine you are in a basketball stadium and there are people sitting in the seats and you want to get peanuts to those people. And so with direct addressing, you say, give this bag of peanuts to Jane. And you go and you give that bag of peanuts to Jane. And then you say, give this bag of peanuts to Bob. So you go and give it to Bob. And then you say, give this bag of peanuts to Mary. Go give it to Mary. Well, that can be a bit tedious when you can say, well, they're all sitting right next to each other. So give a bag of peanuts to Bob and everybody to his right, the six people to his right. And then somebody knows, okay, at that address where Bob is located, that plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one. And that is kind of the benefit of indirect addressing, is that way, instead of having to individually address each one of those spots, you can do a whole series of things that are right next to each other or separated in a certain pattern very, very easily. So that's one of the huge benefits of indirect addressing or pointers. And there's probably a huge amount of other ways, but that is the way we are going to be using it. And that's actually one of the ways that Microchip uses it as an example in their code as well. So it does take a little bit more to wrap your mind around it, but in cases like this where you are trying to point at things that are in a consecutive line, it makes things easier, makes the code faster, and all around is better once you get past that initial mind wrapping issue. So now that we've talked about some of the concepts that we are going to be dealing with, let's jump into the code itself. It's pretty long and it looks kind of crazy at first, but really it's just a bunch of different things. And once you get the overall structure, it'll be fine. Okay, so looking at the code, we have our normal, everything's initialized and we're putting values with the EQUs from lines 8 to 14. One of the things I do want to point out is on line 4, we are putting in the code that is going to be used as a comparison. So for us to use this, we are going to need to type in the code 2311. So in this case, I have it set up, and if you follow the schematic that we may have flashed up on the screen or may not have, but definitely have on circuitbread.com, you have 2311 just to have that be the code that opens and closes. So that is where you're putting in the code that will be referenced. The other huge thing that we need to talk about is line 14, that num1. And that's the first number register. And that is the first one of the numbers that we will be using to compare with the code. We don't have to have numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4 because we're doing the indirect addressing. And because all we need to know, like going back to that first example, you just need to know that Jane was in 1 and that there are 3 more people right next to her. So let's keep on going. We initialize things in lines 18 through 25. We want this to start up and initialize to the lock being closed. So that's why we have that in 23, 24. It's just basically making sure that whenever it starts up, the lock is closed and we're moving on. And then we start going to where it looks a little bit crazy, but really all we're doing is reading buttons and doing the debounce like we've done in prior projects. So it won't be too terrible. And number 29, we check the buttons. Now, once we get the buttons, that is not only checking to see that a button was pressed, but it is also checking to see which button was pressed. And so it comes back and the check button subroutine down lower can look at that really quick and notice that it's checking to see if switch 1, switch 2, or switch 3 was pressed. And then depending on which one was actually pressed, it returns the proper value, or if nothing was pressed, returns a 0. And then it takes that and it goes back up. And then you have lines 34, 35 to do the debounce. In that and literal W, what that's doing is it's returning 8 bits, but you want to make sure that the top 6, basically just bits 2 through 7, are ignored. They're complete garbage. You're only going to be returning a 0, 1, 2, or 3, which you can do with the bottom 2 bits. And so that's all that ANDLW is for with the 3, is to make sure that you're getting rid of anything in there that's not supposed to be there. So you keep on going. I will point out one thing. The way this is set up is that if the lock is open and you just push any button, it'll immediately close. And so that's why in lines 46 and 47, you're checking, oh, the lock's already open, a button has been pushed, close it, and then jump back and start the whole thing over again. Otherwise, if it is already closed and you're getting the button reads, you keep on going, fill up your buffer with the input before finally jumping into line 53, where you now compare the codes between what is input and what you have that we established back up at the top of the file. So I'm gonna get into a little bit more detail between lines 53 and 63, because this is where we're checking the code and this is where we're using the indirect addressing. So in 54, we are putting the code that we've gotten and putting it into the working register so that we can actually deal with it. And also because we're going to be manipulating it and we don't want to mess up the original value that we got. So we take that code, we put it into the working register, and then again, we clear out everything but the bottom two bits of what's in the working register. And that way we can check the first number. So we subtract what is in the indirectly addressed register, which is basically that num1 that we established up at the top. And if the result is not zero, that means that they are not the same, that what is in the bottom two bits of the code that was entered and the bottom two bits of the code that you're expecting, they should be the same. And if they subtract and you get zero, then they're the same. Otherwise, they're not. And if they're not the same, then you do not skip the next line and you go to the top of the loop. So you basically start the whole thing over again. If it is the same, then you go down to lines 59 and 60, where you do that shift right register twice to move everything over. So then later you can compare that. So 59, 60, you shift everything to the right twice. 61, you increment the indirect address. So now you're changing from Jane to Bob, or from the first number that you want to compare with the second number that you want to compare. And then you decrement the count to check to see, hey, have we checked all of them? And we haven't at this point. So we go back up to check the code, where we do the exact same thing. We take everything, we put in the working register, we get rid of everything that we don't want to look at, we subtract it, we check to see if it's zero. If it's still zero, great, that means it's the same. Shift everything to the right, increment the indirect address, decrement the count. If the count's still not zero, go up and do that. So it should be doing that four times. And then if you go through and it is correct every single time, then you're going to finally skip that go to check code and you're gonna go straight into line 65, where you open the lock and everything is great. Then once you've manipulated the servo, you've opened it up, then you jump up and you start the whole thing over again. So while there were a lot of moving parts to this code, it actually wasn't too bad, each one individually. So it could seem a little bit overwhelming at first, but all of these things individually should be pretty straightforward. And as always, if you do still have questions and you've watched this two or three times, we have each one of these lines basically described in detail on circuitbread.com with the written tutorial that Sergey did. So all of this stuff is based on those written tutorials that Sergey wrote, and they're on circuitbread.com. That, again, that's down in the description. The link straight to this tutorial should be there. And so if you have any more questions or you want further detail, please go check that out. As it is, I'm gonna program this thing up and I'm gonna show it to you in action, and then we'll be done for the day. So let me get that done. All right, it's programmed. Let's see if I did this successfully. One of the things that I found when I was testing this and Sergey has had the same problem is that for some reason, all of these programming lines are affecting the switch reads. So I'm going to unplug everything from the picket that is on the same line as one of the buttons. And then I'm gonna start going through this. Which one is that? There we go. So now, again, the code is 2311. So the way I have these set up is 1, 2, 3. So it's 2, 3, 1, 1. The interesting thing is the way this is set up is if you're off and it's expecting four button inputs. And so if you put in the code and it's off by one, then you need to put in the code and then hit another extra random button to shift everything, put in the code, still doesn't work, shift, put in another random button to shift everything and keep on doing that until you get it. So 2, 3, 1, 1. Nope. Let's try that again. 2, 3, 1, 1. I hope I'm not just making a fool of myself here. There we go. Now we're aligned. So that was it. That was the movement. Now the interesting thing is for a servo, the way it works is if you stop giving it any pulses, it just stays where it is, but then it's pretty easy to move. And that's the way we have it set up. Whereas if you want it to stay in place no matter whether or not you're trying to move it, then you need to constantly give it that pulse. But that's not necessary for what we're doing, so that's why I can move it like this. Now, like I mentioned, should be able to just hit any button and it should go back, and then I should be able to put the code in again to move it. See, there we go. 2, 3, 1, 1. Yeah. Gonna just sit here all day. don't have anything better to do. So now it's locked again, everything is good to go, and that is the whole thing working. Hope you found this interesting, hope you found it fascinating. Again, there's a whole lot more detail and a lot more information on circuitbread.com, and again, that description to the, the link to this actual tutorial is in the description, so go check it out. If you have not subscribed to our channel, we appreciate the support you would be showing us with a subscription, and that way you can find out more and learn more about not only microcontrollers and things along these lines, but everything about electronics and electrical engineering. If you liked it, give it a like, all that jazz, but we will see you in the next one. Take care.